thank our camper for this evening. It's not here, so it's just you and me, so say thanks a lot.
Good evening and welcome to St. Faustina Parish. Father Sean will be away this, the end of this week, so there will be no Mass at St. Christopher on Thursday and no Mass at St. Louis on Friday. Also, no confessions on Friday. The office will be closed on Monday, July 4th for the holiday. We are still in need of setup help for the festival on Saturday the 16th and Thursday the 21st. Please see the bulletin for more information. Also needed for the festival are donated cans of pop and water. Please leave in the social hall. All who have signed up to volunteer at the festival, please attend the picnic and informational meeting on Thursday at St. Christopher's Pavilion at 6:30 p.m. Join the youth ministry for a kickball game on Monday, July 11th. Meet at the Newman Center at 7 p.m. The 14th annual Knights of Columbus charitable golf outing is Saturday, July 30th. If you do not golf, you can help this cause by sponsoring a hole or by making a donation. All proceeds will benefit the family of Mark Masala. Brochures are at the entrance of the church. If you volunteer in our parish, you must have current clearances and must have completed the new version of Protecting God's Children online training. Please call Pamela at the office on Tuesday, Thursday, or Friday to inquire about your status or if you are a new volunteer.
Thank you. these days celebrates our Independence Day, and so we thank God for the gift of our country. We pray always for our country, for all people that look to us as an example. And we certainly come together on this very special weekend to receive the great love that our Lord gives to us in this most blessed sacrament, and in order that we can prepare ourselves to receive Him worthily, we do call to mind times in our lives that we've sinned, but we remember also how compassionate God is and forgiving, and so we ask Him for pardon and strength.
You were sent to Him with contrite of heart. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
You came to call sinners. Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
You are seated at the right hand of the Father to intercede for us. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life.
Amen.
Thank you.
praise to you. Sing praise to your name. Conceive the works of God, his tremendous deeds among the children of Adam.
Go out into the streets and say, the dust of your own town they even that you shake off against you. Yet know this, the kingdom of God is at hand. I tell you, it will be more tolerable for Sodom on that day than for that town. The 72 returned rejoicing and said, Lord, even the demons are subject to us because of your name. Jesus said, I have observed Satan fall like lightning from the sky. Behold, I have given you the power to tread upon serpents and scorpions, and upon the force of the enemy, and nothing will harm you. Nevertheless, do not rejoice because the spirits are subject to you, but rejoice because your names are written in heaven. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Historically, this number is associated with abundance, prosperity, good health. Yet they're unnamed. The question to ask, however, is what did Luke want us to learn from this gospel? This gospel is unique. And as always, we learn much from the Gospel of Luke. We learn about our Blessed Mother, early stories from the life of Jesus. However, Luke's gospel sometimes leaves us with characters who we know very little about. We don't know what the lost sheep did next, or what the woman did with her coin after she found it. It's important to recognize, however, that what seems to matter most to Luke is how people encounter Jesus. Therefore, Luke doesn't need us to know who they were or what happened. We do know that Jesus sent out these 72, and the sending is what is most important. Remember, Christianity starts small, and for that matter, so does humanity. In the Garden of Eden, it begins with a man. However, Christianity, it all begins with a woman. A young girl who says yes to God. Jesus is born, and after about 30 years, he calls 12 men to follow him, to learn from him, to spread the news, the good news, which is the gospel. You see, God will achieve his purpose in our world. But how does he achieve this purpose? We're all followers of Christ. However, did the disciples of Jesus about 2,000 years ago understand the way we understand this gospel here today? They know one thing. Maybe it's a little different than us. They know they have to face Jesus again. Literally, face to face. Eye to eye. And when you look at life from that perspective, knowing that Jesus knows all, sees all, and will hold each of us accountable, suddenly there's a different perspective. An entirely different direction. Yet, what did Jesus tell them? He told them to be ready for rejection. It doesn't seem unreasonable to conclude that the rejection they encounter will be based on the fact that he himself will be rejected by the power, the authority, and the people in Jerusalem. When I read this gospel, I'm reminded of a great saint, St. Dominic. I find it ironic, but not surprising, that St. Dominic took this calling literally, creating a religious order that was designed to go out into the world, owning nothing, having nothing, and spreading the gospel to those who have not met our Savior and Lord Jesus Christ. Down through the ages, Christians have been attacked, rejected. However, we have endured, and we will prevail until the end of time. And we hear hints in this gospel. Explain that those who are sent must take nothing with them for the journey, because somehow even the basic items like a purse or a change of clothes will serve only to slow their progress. St. Dominic got it. In fact, the saints always do. If you read this gospel carefully, you will hear that there is an urgency about their mission, almost as if they are farmers on the way to a harvest, and that harvest has only hours to save that crop. Listen to the last line before they are sent out. No one who puts his hand to the plow and looks back is fit for the kingdom of God. This is serious. This is urgent. They take nothing with them and their towns and villages where they are strangers, nobodies. They have nowhere to lay their heads. They are vulnerable people, putting everything on the line. But it's in this vulnerability that they will be able to go before the face of God. Again, I remind you, we hear something in this gospel that takes us back to the beginning. To Adam, the first man. He started out naked. He was alone until God gave him life. He had everything given to him by God. That is until he sinned. Then he clothed himself. Remember, God questioned him about it. Even though God knew everything that had happened, Adam's innocence was gone. The name Adam literally means dust, Adamos. It's no coincidence that on Ash Wednesday we hear, "You are dust, and to dust you will return." So when we hear that the feet of these disciples would be covered with the dust they would encounter, the impure dust must go. Shake it off and move on. Perhaps these 72, with the sending, was really about, was upon the return. Because they're full of joy, because of the power over evil that he's given them. As a reminder to all of us, we all have free will. Said another way, we don't have to go along with evil unless we choose. That notion in and of itself makes this gospel essential, because it reminds us of several things. First, each of us will meet Jesus Christ face to face, eye to eye, and give an account for every moment that we have lived on this earth. We will be responsible for what we did with the time God has granted us. Second, you heard it in this gospel. The devil is real, very real. The devil is evil. He represents all of the following: hatred, murder, cruelty, neglect, eternal torture, wanting nothing more than to convince each of us that doing wrong is good. Putting into our minds that accepting evil is okay. To Satan, evil is not evil. Evil is good. And keep in mind that Satan does not sleep. He's relentless in trying to distract us into believing things like, "The church doesn't do that anymore." Or, "It's okay if it makes you feel good." Nobody will know. The devil wants to make us think that morality is subjective. You can do whatever you want. Because the devil wants us to believe that our opinions supersede even the teachings of Jesus. But if you listen to today's gospel, we say not so fast. Even the ancient cultures that were not Christian recognized the notion of sacrifice. And believe it or not, there are some common ground that we have with them. The Romans, the Jewish people, the Native Americans, the ancient Greeks, the Vikings, and on. They all made sacrifices. They understood that sacrificing animals, weapons, jewelry, depriving themselves of certain things, was part of the human exchange with the spiritual world. Why did they make these sacrifices? Because they knew that the sacrifice was necessary. But God had to show them that they did not have it right. Which is why God came here for us, and why Jesus was sacrificed for us on a cross. The road to the kingdom of heaven is is traveled by us through sacrifices. Having a family requires a sacrifice. Being married requires a sacrifice. Going to church requires a sacrifice. Being a priest requires a sacrifice. Giving alms to the poor requires a sacrifice. Being a parent requires a sacrifice. Every human being conceived is brought into this world with a soul, and ultimately created by God to go on a journey that leads to a meeting with Jesus face to face and the hope of spending eternity in heaven. And the easiest way to defeat evil is to do good. And more often than not, to do that, it requires some type of sacrifice. These disciples that we heard about in today's gospel found joy. But to do that, they had to make a sacrifice. The joy was not for what they did in their own names, but in the fact that their names are written in heaven. They overcame all of the obstacles and lures of this earth, not only to find God, but to bring God to those who do not know Him. They understood that a rough road now has an eternal reward later. And this tells us that we're called go out into the world to announce the gospel of the Lord. Each and every day, preparing ourselves to meet Jesus face to face. I'll close with this. St. Paul, who started out by not being a follower of Christ, in fact, he was an enemy, he changed, and he became one of the greatest saints ever. St. Paul tells us, nothing in all creation is hidden from God. Everything is naked and exposed before His eyes, and He is the one to whom we are accountable.
Christ's message of love and healing bring them back into His loving arms.
our independence, we ask you to please shed your grace upon our country. Please help all people to be united in common peace and fellowship. Help us to come together and see the value and the true miracle of every life and the gift of our lives. Thank you for so many blessings that you've given us. And help us to always spread the gospel to all that we meet through our deeds and actions, by hearing our prayers as well. For we make them in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen.
This is where we start prayers and our concerns to the altar today. Please join together in singing number 435. Be not afraid, number 435.
Christ our Lord, for out of compassion for the waywardness that is ours, the humbled himself, and by the Holy Spirit was born of the Virgin. By the passion of the cross, he freed us from unending death, and by rising from the dead, he gave us life eternal. And so with all the angels and saints, we too sing the hymn of your glory as without end, we acclaim. In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, take this, all of you, and drink from it. For this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me. church and recognizing the sacrificial victim of his death. You will to reconcile us to yourself, grant that we who are nourished by the body and blood of your Son and filled with his Holy Spirit may become one body, one spirit in Christ. May he make of us an eternal offering to you so that we may attain an inheritance of your elect, especially with the most blessed Virgin, Mary, Mother of God, the blessed Joseph, her spouse, their blessed apostles and glorious martyrs, with St. Elizabeth and Seton, St. Damien of Molokai, St. John Henry Cardinal Neumann, and with all the saints on whose constant intercession in your presence we rely for unfailing help. May the sacrifice of our reconciliation, we pray, O Lord, advance the peace and salvation of all the world. Be pleased to confirm in faith and charity your pilgrim church on earth with your servant Francis, our Pope, and David, our Bishop, the order of bishops, all the clergy, and the entire people you have named for your own. Listen graciously to the prayers of this family, whom you summon before you in your compassion, O merciful Father. Gather to yourself all your children scattered throughout the world, to our departed brothers and sisters, and to all who are pleasing to you at their passing from this life. Give kind admittance to your kingdom there, we hope, to enjoy forever the fullness of your glory through Christ our Lord, through whom you bestow on the world all that is good. Through him, and with him, and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. Thank you. God, the only one who takes away the sins of the world, blessed are those who are called to the supper of the Lamb.
Lord, have mercy.
Thank you. we may gain the prize of salvation and never cease to praise you through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Prayer to St. Michael the Archangel.
St. Michael the Archangel, defend us in battle. Be our protection against the wickedness and snares of the devil.
May God
rebuke him when I'm afraid. And if thou, Prince of the heavenly host, by the power of God, cast you in our Satan and all the evil spirits who prowl about the world seeking to ruin our souls. Amen.
Everybody, I hope you have a great 4th of July. You know, for your families and loved ones. There's an old saying, I don't know if I'm getting it right, like, your corn is knee high by 4th of July. Is that a thing? Okay, I got to know if it's a real saying or not. It sounds good. But like knee high by 4th, I don't know if it's knee high or not. It's getting there, right? It's hard to believe that it's July 4th, but I do hope you have a beautiful evening and a great weekend with your families. The Lord be with you.
Amen.
May Almighty God bless you, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Go and announce the gospel.
Praise
God.
Let's go forth this afternoon thanking God for all the blessings he's bestowed on our country as we sing number 745, America the Beautiful.